So this video allows me to work in one of my favorite words in astronomy, which I wanted to put into a video for a long time, which is syzygy.
Syzygy?
Syzygy. Isn't that a great word?
Yeah.
Good for Scrabble. Syzygy in astronomy is a co-alignment, a lining up of three bodies in some sort of gravitational alignment. So we're used to this all the time when we have eclipses. We've got a syzygy of the Earth and the Sun and the Moon in different combinations, depending on which kind of eclipse it is. And yesterday, there was a syzygy in the solar system because the planet Jupiter was at opposition. And that means it is directly opposite the Sun as seen from Earth. So we're here on Earth, the Sun is in one direction, Jupiter is directly opposite, which makes it great for viewing, and we get a clear view. It's up all night, it's really bright and very nice. And so this made me think, how do we get from one planet to another? If Jupiter is in opposition, which means it's pretty much as close as it's gonna get to us, wouldn't this be the best time to be sending a mission to Jupiter? And the answer, of course, is no. And so what we're gonna explore in this video today is the challenges of moving around the solar system when everything else is in motion and we've got gravity to contend with. One of my favorite recent series has been The Expanse. Have you seen The Expanse?
I have not.
You would love The Expanse. It's a story that's entirely set in the solar system. So the solar system has been colonized, the other planets in the asteroid belt have been colonized. A real prominent character in the stories is gravity, is the challenges of getting around the solar system, the challenges of growing up and living in lower gravity environments, what that means, and particularly the challenges of getting from one place to the other and everything that that involves. So that's kind of what I wanted to talk about today, because, you know, all the graphics that we see of the solar system have the planets lined up, you know, in a line. You would see that, obviously not to scale.
No, and Australia's upside down, which I like. I can see
great,
it.
Great.
I can see Australia.
Just for you, did that just for you. And even in science fiction, this happens a lot. You think, right, you go to Jupiter, and then you go a little further, and you get to Saturn.
There's no Pluto.
And Pluto's not a planet. We made a whole video about
it. Leaving.
Okay, so the point is, the planets are not. We all know this. The planets are not arranged in this nice line. Just because we get to Jupiter doesn't mean that if we go a little further, we get to Saturn, because these things are actually orbiting in circles around the Sun, or ellipses. And, you know, Jupiter might be over here in one configuration and Saturn might be way over here.
Have they ever been in a perfect line?
I'm sure we could cycle back through the solar system calculator and find lots of syzygies in the solar system. I don't think it's very likely that everything's been in a line, but that would be a neat thing to look for.
Maybe that's where they started. I'm joking.
You're really trolling me today.
I am.
Okay, so this is a view of where the solar system planets are today, at least the inner solar system, starting from Jupiter, so Jupiter with its spot there. And then Mars is over here. And then because I said that Jupiter is in opposition, that means that the Earth and the Sun and Jupiter in a straight line. And then further in, you've got Venus and you've got Mercury. And the inner planets are zipping around much faster. The outer planets are moving much more slowly. So let's imagine now that we just want to get from Earth to Jupiter. So how would we do that? We wouldn't send out a rocket pointed at Jupiter right now, because Jupiter's moving. Jupiter's moving slowly. The Earth is moving a little bit more quickly. And so what do we do? The most efficient way to get from one orbit to another is something called a Hohmann transfer orbit. And this is beautiful and simple, because all it needs are two impulses, two changes of velocity, and that will get you from Earth's orbit eventually to Jupiter's orbit. It's not the fastest way, it's the most efficient way. It uses the least amount of fuel, which is obviously going to be a big consideration when you're traveling around the solar system. That might not be the best way to do it in terms of human passengers and protecting them from radiation and keeping them fed and watered and everything, but in terms of pure rocket efficiency. Now, I know from past experience that we've got many viewers out there who are participants in the Kerbal Space Program, which is a solar system simulator. And I know that when I talk about the Hohmann transfer orbits, the hairs on the back of their neck will be going up and saying, okay, yes, but there's more complicated orbits and there's more things to think about. And that's absolutely true. This, as many things are in our explanations of physics is simplified. This is the simplest orbit. It's assuming that the two bodies are perfectly in the same plane. It's assuming that they're starting on very circular orbits, and it's neglecting the gravitational effects from other bodies. That being said, this is how you would get from Earth to Jupiter using a Hohmann transfer orbit. All you have to do is, at the right point, you want to launch your spacecraft from Earth orbit. We'll neglect getting off the Earth. We'll assume we're in the same orbit around the Sun as the Earth is. And all you want to do is add velocity in a tangential direction. So we want to give it an instantaneous boost that way. What is that going to do? We've known for hundreds of years, since Kepler came up with his laws that beautifully describe the motions of the planets, that the planets orbit the Sun in elliptical orbits with the Sun at one focus. So if we're starting from a relatively circular orbit here, and we add that impulse, we make this into a bigger ellipse. If we do it just right, we'll then follow an elliptical path, and if we time it just right, that elliptical orbit will have its furthest distance from the Sun, its aphelion, right at the intersection with Jupiter's orbit. So that gets us where we want to go. Now we just have to get the timing right. And so what we have to calculate is when to make that maneuver in order that we catch up with Jupiter and we cross that orbit. Oh, it's not Earth that's going. And we cross that orbit just as Jupiter gets there. So that's only half the story, though. Because if that's all we do, we'll fall back in on this orbit and we'll continue back into this nice elliptical orbit that will cross Earth's orbit at one end and Jupiter's orbit at the other. And when SpaceX launched the Tesla Roadster into orbit and said it was going to Mars, this is what it did. It went into an orbit that took it across the orbit of Mars, but then it's come back again and it's going to be in that Mars-Earth loop until something else changes it.
I wonder where that car is.
Oh, you can track it. I found a website.
Okay.
So it is on its way back to Earth's orbit, not to Earth, just like it didn't get to Mars because Mars wasn't there when it crossed Mars' orbit. It's going to come back to Earth's orbit, but Earth is going to be on the other side of the Sun.
Will it get to one of them one day? Will one of them happen to be there when it will either get back to Earth or Mars?
Presumably, if it lasts long enough and you forward this infinitely, but what's more likely is that it'll be broken up or disturbed or something. The chances of it actually hitting either is very, very slim. Right, so we sent our spacecraft on a transfer orbit to Jupiter. When we get there, if we don't do anything else to the spacecraft, it's just going to follow this elliptical orbit. We need to change its velocity again so that we match the orbital speed of Jupiter. And so then you apply one more impulse. So that's all you need is two impulses, two changes in velocity, one at Earth's orbit, one at Jupiter's orbit, tangential to the direction of the planet's travel. It's called circularizing the orbit. You're going to change from that elliptical orbit into a nice circular orbit matching Jupiter.
What is the impulse when I get to Jupiter's orbit?
When we get to Jupiter, we have to apply another tangential kick in velocity to speed up to match Jupiter's orbital speed. Now, if you wanted to get into Jupiter's orbit around Jupiter, or if you wanted to land on Jupiter, that would require even more velocity change. In terms of rocket trajectories, we talk about a delta V budget. So delta is the Greek symbol that we use for change, and delta V is just the total amount of velocity changes you need to make your maneuver happen. Forget Jupiter for a minute. If we're trying to land on Mars, some of that delta V could be acquired through aerobraking. If you want to land on a planet, you need to slow down or you're just going to slam right into it. So there's some atmosphere on Mars, not very much, but some of that velocity you can lose by aerobraking. This would take 33 months to get from Earth to Jupiter by this orbital transfer, and that might not be what you want. So, for example, the New Horizons spacecraft was sent on a mission to explore Pluto, and a transfer orbit to get from Earth's orbit to Pluto would take 46 years, which isn't so good if you're trying to plan your career and solve scientific problems. That's a lot of waiting around. In actual fact, New Horizons got to Pluto in 8.5 years. How did that work? Well, two things. First of all, it wasn't trying to insert itself into orbit at Pluto's distance from the Sun or around Pluto. it just went screaming by really, really fast. And so there you don't have to worry about these beautiful ellipses. You just apply as much rocket fuel as you can in the right direction at the right time, and off you go. And so when New Horizons launched, it was the fastest object made by humans launched from the Earth. Okay, so it went screaming away from the Earth at about 16 kilometers per second. And that's enough to escape the solar system. It was helped on the way by passing by Jupiter. So as many of the outer system probes have, it got a little kick, it got a gravity boost by flying by Jupiter. And by falling towards Jupiter, it slowed down Jupiter a tiny, tiny amount. And some of that momentum was transferred to the spacecraft and sort of flung it out even further into the outer solar system. This was used famously by the Voyager 2 spacecraft when the NASA scientists planning the mission realized there was a very fortuitous alignment of planets, which meant that they could visit not just Jupiter and Saturn, but then change the trajectory to swing around and see Uranus and Neptune as well.
It always seems funny to me that this doesn't slow them down. Surely I would have thought there were ways in which going by something like Jupiter would slow down hurtling out of the solar system.
Yeah, absolutely. It all depends on the direction in which you approach it. And so these gravity slingshots can be used to slow spacecraft down just as they can to speed them up. And that's in fact how we get to the inner solar system. You can imagine the solar system as this big well, this gravity well. And to get out, you have to apply energy and escape. And so you might think, well, it must be easy then to just roll down the hill and drop down into the inner solar system. But that neglects the fact that we're traveling really fast in a tangential direction around the sun. That's why we don't fall into the sun. It's because we're traveling really, really, really fast in a sideways direction. That's why when we try to send things into orbit around the Earth, we don't just send things straight up and then they don't come down again. We send things up, get them through the atmosphere, and then we send them sideways really, really fast. And what happens then is that they're constantly falling towards the Earth, but they're falling so fast that they keep missing it continuously and falling round and round the other side, just as we're continuously missing the sun as we fall around the solar system. And so what do we need to do to get into the inner solar system? We need to slow down some of that sideways motion. So we do the same thing. Apply a tangential delta V to our spacecraft velocity, but this time we're not trying to add velocity to it. We're trying to take away velocity. And when we take away some of that sideways Earth motion, we start to fall towards the inner solar system. And this is how we've got spacecraft to Venus, to Mercury, and most recently, how we've sent the Parker Solar Probe in towards the sun.
Liftoff of the mighty Delta IV heavy rocket with NASA's Parker Solar Probe, a daring mission to shed light on the mysteries of our closest star, the sun.
This is a spacecraft that is designed to get as close as we've ever been to the sun. It will actually pass within 10 times the radius of the sun. It'll fly through the solar corona, the outer atmosphere of the sun, to try to learn about it. It's an incredible mission. It's not a straightforward maneuver to just cancel out all of this Earth's orbital motion. Again, they are using, this time, Venus for a flyby. And this time we're going to do exactly what you suggested, is come at it from the other direction, which will speed Venus up a tiny bit and slow the Parker Solar Probe down enough to gradually change its orbit into a nice tight elliptical orbit that's going to send it eventually screaming around the sun at 0.06% the speed of light when it reaches its maximum orbital velocity in 2024. And it's going to take 7 flybys of Venus to make that happen.
So how do like current Mars probes get there?
Pretty much this is the way that we are restricted to at the moment. Until we build much bigger propulsion systems or much more efficient propulsion systems, we are simply stuck with the fact that doing anything else would require so much fuel, both on the beginning end but also at the other end, that it's just not practical to do anything but the most efficient maneuvers. Now, there are, you know, obviously some subtleties. There are some extra things that you can do here. You can do powered slingshot maneuvers where you fire your engine right at the deepest part of the potential well. That's the most efficient place to add the extra impulse. But by and large, we are restricted to these launch windows for which everything lines up just right so that we can send things in the most efficient manner.
Is it going to be this way when we start sending things to other stars as well? Is that how it's going to work? Is it going to be, you know, where's this star going to be when we launch this thing and that? Or is it, there's going to be other ways of doing this by that time? Like,
there may be some really interesting technologies with solar sails, just catching the solar wind and just very slowly but consistently accelerating to a very high velocity and then reversing that somehow on the other end.
Imagine that. Oh, where's Andromeda going to be in 10,000 years and something and sending things off? And
I mean, this is something astronomers have to worry about, just in terms of finding our way around the sky. Everything is moving. The stars are apparently moving on timescales that we can measure, on timescales that cause problems for us as astronomers. And so if you're trying to get from one place to another, depending on what those timescales are, yeah, you have to take into account that everything is moving relative to everything else. But that's going to be a long way away.
Here are two videos on my Objectivity channel. I'd love it if you go and have a look at them. They're new ones. One is about the American Apollo moon rocks, and this other one is about some grains of sand brought back from the moon by the Soviets. I'll put links on the screen and in the description. I think you might enjoy them.
26 grains of sand.
Brady, you've just held a piece of the moon. How cool is that?
Indeed, because these 26 grains of sand are Russian moon dust.
So this is Apollo 15 sample 15415. It's the Genesis rock.